his phrasing and styling.
Always lay with your kisses. Won't you come in my arms, sweet darling, stay. Always lay.
In many ways, Lefty's life paralleled that of Hank Williams. Both were plagued by alcoholism and stormy relationships. But although Lefty's recording career spanned almost 25 years, he never managed to sustain the stellar success he'd enjoyed during the early 50s, when his career stood on an equal footing with Hank Williams. They even toured together in April 1951. There's enough stories there to fill a book, Lefty once said, but he never told them.
And it wasn't long after that that even though he found new love with Billie Jean, he still had Audrey in his heart and his mind, and he wrote Your Cheatin' Heart about her.
Your cheatin' heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try to sleep.
He, of course, accused her of infidelity, and I suppose that's pretty well documented, that they were both unfaithful to one another. And so he's singing in that song about her infidelity.
When tears come down like falling rain.
It's Hank's anthem. It's his musical last will and testament. And it's searing, it's powerful, it's gripping. If you want to say this is his last and best work, I wouldn't argue with that.
Your cheating heart will.
At the time he wrote Your Cheating Heart, Hank was sharing a house with another musician who got to know him well.
He was really tortured over his divorce. He really went off the deep end. And his last statement was, if we don't get back together, I'll die in a year. And he knew it was happening. And that was New Year's Eve in 1952, and he died New Year's Eve in 1953.
On that fateful New Year's Eve, Hank was being driven north to a gig in Ohio. He had been drinking heavily.
I was playing 50 miles away in Akron, Ohio, and he was in Canton. And we were going to have lunch together. It was on New Year's Day. And he didn't make it. Broke my heart. I loved him.
The way I do. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
Hank Williams' death at just 29 from an alcohol and drugs-induced heart attack shook the world of country music. At the funeral in Montgomery, Alabama, a crowd of 20,000 lined up to pay their respects. Among them was Ray Price, who was determined to keep the honky-tonk spirit of Hank's music alive.
Hank Williams liked Ray Price, and they wrote songs together and played together, and Hank got him on the Opry. And he would take Ray on the road with us, and Hank would let him sing and stuff. And so after Hank's death, we continued to play for Ray Price.
But it wasn't that simple.
I was so into Hank as a friend that it began to drift into my music. And we were playing one night, and this fellow come up and said, I want to thank you for doing what you're doing. You sound more like old Hank every day. So going home that night, I told him, I said, I love all you guys, but we gotta split, because they couldn't play anything but that one sound.
Ray Price would later take on the Cherokee Cowboys, and with this new sound, he had a massive hit in 1956 with Crazy Arms.
The way that I feel.
and a storm's brewing in this heart of mine. This ain't no crazy dream, I know that it's real. You're someone else's love now, you're not mine.
Crazy Arms was number one in the country charts for an unprecedented 20 weeks and sold a million copies.
Somebody new, for my yearning heart keeps saying you're not mine.
Part of its huge success was a driving rhythm called the 4-4 shuffle beat. It was to feature heavily in many of the hits to come.
What Ray Price did that he's probably the best known for, among musicians anyway, was Ray popularized what we call the 4-4 shuffle beat in music. And that is, the bass plays, instead of the normal two beats to the measure, doom, doom, on Ray Price's, it's doom, 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 doom.
And that's what the bass plays. Well, the drum is playing the 4 beat with his foot, and he's shuffling with his stick and brush. And so it comes out a dun da dun da dun da dun.
A bright array of city lights.
Ray Price was to take his winning formula and apply it to songs like Heartaches by the Number and City Lights.
Through the night, for lonely guys like me.
But in spite of Ray Price's success, the foundations of country music were about to be rocked to the core.
A broken heart to lose itself in the glow of...
Price went from a Hank Williams imitator to being the premier honky-tonk singer and stylist at the time rock and roll hit.
All hell broke out in 1956 when America discovered Elvis. His arrival put the country music industry in crisis, as hordes of young fans of honky-tonk music deserted it for the irresistible charms of the teen sensation from Memphis. For a while, it seemed like country music would simply wither and die under the onslaught of rock and roll.
You ain't nothing but...
Actually, Hank Snow was the first person who told us about Elvis. He had played some dates with Elvis, and he came back and told us at the Grand Ole Opry on Saturday night when we saw him. He said, "Well, that little boy down here, long sideburns, and you can't follow the little so and so on the stage." And the audience hollered everywhere. We want Elvis.
And he stopped his song. He said, "If you'll just let me finish this number, we'll get the little bastard back out here."
Yeah, they said you were high class, well, edible just a lie. Yeah, you ain't never put
a... Rock and roll may have provoked panic, but it also provided an opportunity. Country artists had always had to fight for recognition and credibility outside the country charts. The wider music industry had a long tradition of ridiculing country as unsophisticated hillbilly music, twangy and uncultured. Now, though, a number of producers in Nashville saw that the old rules were breaking down and that if a record didn't sound too country, it could offer an alternative to rock and roll. What they came up with was a new radio-friendly brand of country pop, which smoothed out the twang and became known as the Nashville sound.
Touch me, touch the girl who once held all the world.
The producers in Nashville, whose country sales went down at the time rock and roll hit, said, "Why don't we change country a little and appeal to some of these pop fans who are so turned off by rock and roll that they might give a different style of country a listen."
The architects of the Nashville sound were Owen Bradley of Decca Records and Chet Atkins at RCA. As the two leading producers in Nashville, they would be responsible for shaping the careers of many new stars and creating a sound that would dominate the next 20 years.
What they began to do was to smooth out the sound, you know, drop the fiddle, maybe not emphasize the steel guitar as much, add a vocal chorus, add a string section. Quite a departure from the country that was popular in the late 40s and early 50s.
South of the border, hey, I know that he's got more fun than anybody.
Jim Reeves would prove to be the ideal candidate for the Nashville Sound treatment. He'd started out in the Texas honky-tonks, but once he began working with Chet Atkins at RCA, he became one of the first country singers to cross over successfully to the highly lucrative world of pop.
Jim Reeves had tried, I guess you'd call it honky-tonk music. He's rather successful at it.
Always on the go, sunshine and down on Mexican Joe.
He had hits like Mexican Joe and Bimbo, sung in a high register, sung with the fiddle and the steel and so forth. But his voice was such that it adapted very well to this different sound that the producers were after once rock and roll hit.
Four walls to hear me.
Four Walls was the first great Nashville Sound record. Released in 1957, it was the turning point in Reeves' career, proving to himself and his producer, Chet Atkins, the huge potential of this new kind of country music.
Closing in on me. One night with you is like heaven.
Reeves knew exactly what he was doing. He had studied diction, and he had this hypnotic baritone that just mesmerized his listeners.
And wait.
It was Reeves's idea to get in close to the microphone, and he did that expertly on Four Walls, for example.
He was like a half inch from the microphone itself, maybe even closer on some things, and turned sideways to keep from popping his P's and going huffing his H's. But then they were able to bring that volume up because they got no feedback from the room. And they make you sound like you're on the stage performing and you're just standing there, hardly breathing.